Sunday we heard Jesus saying, I am the good shepherd. And today we have another one of those I am statements where he says, I am the vine and you are the branches. And he's inviting us, his hearers, to place our rest and refuge into him. As we go on, he says, abide in me. And then the epistle lesson, John equates this abiding in him with the love that God gives to us. And then in the epistle lesson today, it's the story of the Ethiopian eunuch. And Philip comes along and he baptizes him. And it's all about staying connected to Jesus. And that's our theme this morning. Are we connected to Jesus? And so our theme today is connect with the vine and your life is fine. And we pray for that right now. Let's stand now as we sing our first hymn, Rock of Ages. Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the readings.
First,
First lesson comes from Acts chapter 8, verses 26 through 40. Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." So he started out, and on his way he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury in Canaan, which means Queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah, the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, "Go to that chariot and stay near it." Then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah, the prophet. "Do you understand what you are reading?" Philip asked. "How can I?" he said, "unless someone explains it to me." So he invited Philip to come in and sit with him. This is a passage of the scripture the eunuch was reading. "He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, as a lamb before its shearer is silent. So he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth." The eunuch asked Philip, "Tell me, please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else?" Then Philip began with that very passage of the scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. As they traveled along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What can stand in the way of my being baptized?" And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him again, but went on his way rejoicing. Philip, however, appeared at Azotus and traveled about, preaching the gospel in all the towns until he reached Caesarea. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading comes from 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. "Test the spirits, God is love. Dear friends, do not believe in every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in flesh is from God, but every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of Antichrist, which you have heard is coming and even now is already in the world. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. They are from the world and therefore speak from the viewpoint of the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God, and whoever knows God listens to us, but whoever is not from God does not listen to us. This is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love and does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we may live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sin. Dear friends, since God has so loved us, we also ought to love one another. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 15th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus is speaking to us this morning. He says, "I am the vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine, and neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. If you remain in me, and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And if you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown in the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated as we sing our sermon hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Society Because we don't have a relationship with one another. We have a relationship with our cell phone or our computer screen. And we oftentimes talk to that better than we do our own spouse or our children. Now today, Jesus in the gospel lesson is saying something very clear to us. It's an illustration of a story of a vine and the branches to bring into light how important it is that we have a vital, personal relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus. And as we have a relationship with Him, all of a sudden, we are going to produce results. So here's a personal question. I can't answer it for you. You have to answer it yourself. But do you have a vital connection with your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? It's a crucial, crucial question. Because Jesus in the lesson today says, I am the vine and you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. As we pull this text apart, there's all kinds of points that could be lifted out. And you're just as smart as me and you're going to pull out some that maybe I didn't think of. But I want to focus on three this morning. And the first one is, apart from Jesus, we can do nothing. And right away, we get our feathers ruffled. What do you mean I can't do nothing? Well, apart from Jesus, nothing we do has a lasting, permanent, or eternal value. Oh, we all did a lot of things yesterday, didn't we? We might have followed our to-do list and checked a bunch of things off, or we might have went here and there. We did lots of things. But was it anything that truly accomplished lasting value? What really is the most important thing? That's what we're about. And we all have heard that statement, keep the main thing the main thing. And we have to. And that means, are we putting first things first? And in a life as a Christian, that means Jesus first. And that's why Jesus can say, apart from me, you can do absolutely nothing. But there's another lesson inside this lesson. And that is that many Christians, including myself, attempt very little because, well, we dwell in ourselves, not realizing the power of being attached to the vine, the one called Jesus. And thereby, we never truly accomplish all that God has planned for our lives. We all need to understand that our source is our secret, but it is also our strength. We have the ability for fruitful living, not because of just the source, but also the care given us. Just as Jesus is the source, we learn from this text that God the Father is the gardener. And that is alluded to here, that the Father God not only cares for the vine, but He owns it. And when we look at that and understand that, all of a sudden John 3:16 takes on a whole new meaning, doesn't it? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. Now, this is important because we as branches not only have Jesus as our vine, but we have God the Father who cares for us and who prepares us for fruitful living. And there's a difference between having a good resource and owning something. A person who owns something takes good care of it, and they have pride. I learned about pride a long, long time ago when I was 6 or 7 years old. When I was with my grandfather Bartles, Grandpa Bartles. He was my M&M grandpa because he wore overalls and in his pocket were always bags of M&Ms for all the kids. We loved when he came around. But my grandma moved to town and he was getting rid of his farm. And we were out walking around his farm. And as we're walking around, he would show me this building and tell me about this and how he built it and this and what he did here. And we came up to a tractor, and he was one of the first farmers who gave up farming with horses and bought the first tractor in the county. Now he looked at all these things. I looked at him and I saw a shed that had a door off of it. This building needed to be painted, and the tractor didn't even run anymore. It was rusty and under a tree. And yet to him, they were treasures. They were his. They were his pride. I use that illustration because that's how God looks at each one of us. We look at each other, and my grandson says, "Pop, you're getting heavy." Or, "Pop, you got white hair." Or we look at somebody else and we say, "Oh, you don't look good today." Or, "You put on weight since I've seen you a year ago." Or, "What's going on with you? Why do you look this way?" Or, "Why'd you change your hair?" We're mean. We're cruel. We're blunt. We see each other's faults. But that's not how God looks at us. Because he looks at us through his son, Jesus Christ. And when he looks at us through Christ, he sees us as sinless and beautiful and precious. You see, ownership makes a difference. And God owns us. He doesn't look at us as an observer, but rather as an investor. And we need to understand that we can be fruitful because he has invested in us. He invests in us all the time. So that's point number one. Point two, he says, "I'm going to prune you sometimes." Right away, we don't like being pruned. We get concerned about this. Why is he going to prune us? Let's face it. We do all kinds of stretching out here and there, and our lives at times go in 100 different directions at once. And if we try to follow each one of those directions, we're going to crash and burn. And every once in a while, God says, "Oh," and he puts a roadblock there and he stops us. "I ain't going to let you go any further than that road. I'm going to cut you back. And by doing that, you're going to produce better fruit and more fruit." God's going to remove anything that hinders or proves us useless. Did you know that productive people are the ones who are continually being pruned? They are going through the process of God helping them to be more fruitful. The thing about God is he knows exactly where to center in on our lives. Now, as you look at this picture, that's a log jam, isn't it? Now, we don't know much about logging in this part of the country. That's up in the Northwest. But we've seen pictures of it, like now. We've heard stories about it. And the loggers, they cut down the trees, they roll them down the hill, they get into the river, and they float down the river to the mill to be cut up. But every once in a while, there's a log jam. And when this happens, the logger has to climb the tallest tree. And he looks out to see where the jam is. And then he comes down the tree, and he goes to that point, and he throws in a big stick of dynamite. And he blows it up, and all of a sudden, the logs are free to go down the river again. That's exactly what God's word does for your life and my life. It's the power to change us. The dynamis, is the Greek word, is in for power. And God goes directly to those portions of our lives, and he removes the areas that are preventing us from being fruitful. He attacks the sins that keep us from being the one he made us to be. And this is third point. God instructs us to remain in me, he says. He doesn't say, "Hey, would you like to be connected to me? Would you maybe like to believe in me? Would you like to trust me?" No. He says, "Believe in me, remain in me." Period. In other words, we're to stay close to the vine, to Jesus. And as we stay close to the vine, we become faithful and fruitful. 10 times in these next verses, he uses that phrase, "remain in me, remain in me." And potentially, I believe that God is actually saying, "Connect with the vine and your life will be fine." Say that with me. Connect with the vine and your life will be fine. Connect. That's a crucial word. Our Florida Georgia district has been its theme for the last few years, connecting people to Jesus. Are we connecting people to Jesus? Are we connected to Jesus? It's an important word. And each one of us needs to make sure that we are connected with God. That we have a relationship with God. And that the greater the relationship, the greater will be our results. We remain faithful to Him when we worship regularly, receive the sacraments often, grow in grace and knowledge of God through His Word, and share our faith with others. And that's been hard for this past year with COVID. But we try to remain faithful and connected through through the platforms of Facebook and websites and that kind of stuff. But now we need to be together. We need to be the family of God. Try to imagine how discouraging it is for our Lord to see a person become inactive. They've stopped coming to church. They've fallen away. Has the branch broken off or what? And the reality is that we all risk that danger. Paul puts it this way in 1 Corinthians 10:12. He says, we all need to be careful that we don't fall. Statistically, some of us will become inactive. It happens. But I've shared this with you before. As we come out of COVID, it is predicted that more than 30% of our active members will become inactive now because they've fallen away. Some will not be fruitful, faithful worshipers anymore. But it doesn't have to be that way. Our Lord says, remain in me and I will remain in you. And you will not fall away. You will not become severed. You will not break. You will not fall away, he says again. The fruit you produce will be the kind of fruit that God expects from his people. This is the secret to fruitful living. To remain in Jesus. To stick close to him every day of our lives. And a close relationship with Jesus produces confidence. I was a little boy selling pencils on the corner for 5 cents each. And he was doing it because his little brother was sick and he wanted to raise money for a hospital, the town had no hospital. And everybody laughed at him and laughed at him. And what are you doing that for? Why are you doing this? You'll never get that hospital built. It's impossible. And he just smiled and he pointed across the street to the church. And what's on top of the church? The cross of Christ. And he said this. They thought eternal life was impossible too. But I believe that with Christ, all things are possible. That spirit has to be in this room today. There are times when we want to give up. And there are people who are watching from afar and asking, why are we doing what we are doing? And why are you working so hard to keep Holy Cross alive? I also believe that there is so much more that we should be doing and could be doing as we're connected to the vine. God is blessing us. And somehow we continue to strive and share the message of Jesus. And yes, this past year has been a very hard challenge. And people have gotten out of the routines of being together for worship. But we need Jesus. And we need to be connected to Jesus. And we need each other. Just think about this past year. You didn't stop going to the grocery store, did you? You still went and got groceries every week. Or how about eating at a restaurant? Every restaurant I went by yesterday, the parking lot was full. But why isn't the church parking lot full? Why aren't we back here where we had to take more precautions than any other place around? And yet we stay away. We can't. We need to be in this place. We need to encourage others to come back. We need to feast on the Word of God, and we need to feast on His body and blood.
Amen.
And He's inviting us. And He's telling us how important it is to be connected to the vine. And it's time that we look to the cross and realize that this is the Lord's church and not ours, and that we give and use our talents to glorify Him. We witness this ministry every time we gather together, and it may be like selling a pencil for a nickel, but we see lives that are being changed. And just look around. Look who's sitting here this morning. I guarantee you, each one of our lives has been touched because of Jesus, hasn't it? Jesus was the one who said of his relationship to the Father, in John 5:30. He says, I can of myself do nothing. And so it makes a little more sense when we hear Jesus saying, apart from me, you can do nothing. So this morning, have you declared your dependence upon God? Do you have that vital connection with Jesus Christ? Sometimes the trials that we go through, the difficulties that we face in life, are a part of God's pruning. Just like a tree is clipped, cut, and trimmed, it's very painful when we face trials and tribulations and difficulties in our lives. But difficulties also can have great means for us because the Lord is preparing us to bear fruit and more fruit in our lives. And we see as we look back, I know what the Lord was doing at that time. So this morning we need to be thankful for God's pruning and the resources of ministry that He places in our life. And with that thanksgiving, we need to trust the Lord's presence through it all. I say that because we have been chosen and we've been appointed by God to be fruitful. So what kind of fruit is on the vine? You know, I've grown up on a farm. I've shared that story, and my family's tired of it so many times, but that's okay, then you're another one. The happiest day for my father was always the springtime. He would get a catalog in the mail, and it would be about buying fruit trees. And every year, he would order fruit trees, pear trees, peach trees, some that would never grow in Iowa, but he was going to try it anyway, apple trees and cherry trees. And he would get so excited when the envelope would come in the mail. And it was no bigger than this. It was just a twig that had some paper, wet paper, around the bottom. And he would be just the happiest man. And he would go, let's go plant it. And we'd go out and we'd dig a hole. We'd put this little stick in the ground. And then he would put the label. And it always came with labels. Peach tree, pear tree, apple tree. And as we walk away, I just shake my head. Why do we bury this dumb stick? It ain't going to amount to anything. But in the process of time, those little twigs grew up. And after a while, Dad would take the picture labels off of the sign because, well, you could see the fruit. Jesus said to us as Christians, there should be a time in our lives that we can take the label off and should be automatic by the fruits that we are producing that people will see Jesus in us. Because Jesus is just so much a part of our fabric and our being. But the problem often as Christians is that we don't understand what being spirit-filled is all about. And we don't give off those positive attitudes that make us salt and light in our community. But each one gives what each one has to give. And Jesus is telling us that we can give fruitfully only when we are living a fruitful life inwardly. And Jesus goes on in the following verses. And he says that if we remain in him and keep his commandments, we will be fruitful. The key word is if. It's that little word. You may have all seen the statement, if it's up to me, if it's going to be, it's up to me. That's a false statement. If it's going to be, it's up to me as I am connected to Jesus, as I'm connected to the vine. And Jesus is saying to each one of us, are you plugged into me? Because I'm with you always. I have the power and I have the wisdom and I have given you all the gifts and resources needed to build my church. I'm ready. Are you? The problem is we don't remain in him because we think we can do it on our own. We have our own God complex. And our negativity comes in when we are not plugged into Jesus. We should not have to psych ourselves up each morning to get out of bed and face the world. And when you're plugged in with Jesus, you don't have to do that because you know the Lord goes before you and you have nothing to be afraid of or be discouraged about. And as you go forward with that attitude, you're going to lead a fruitful life and you can be productive. Psychologists from Stanford hired a logger, and way, that was a number of years ago, He made over $100 a day, almost $200 a day, chopping down trees with an axe. That's hard work. But it was good money. And so they said to him, "We want you to chop all day, only we don't want you to use the sharp side of the axe. We want you to use the blunt side of the axe. We don't care if you don't cut anything down. We just want you to swing that axe." He lasted about 3 hours when he's normally would do it more than 8 or 9 hours a day, and he walked away. He says, "I quit, keep your money." And they said, "Well, what's wrong?" He says, "If I can't see chips flying, it's no fun. I need to see chips flying." Now, I'm convinced that there are people that are using the wrong end of the axe in ministry. Because we're not seeing the fruit and not seeing things happen before us, then it stops being fun. And maybe at times I've been the reason for stopping that fun. You need to tell me that. Fruitful people want to see the fruit fly. I ask you this morning, look around. Look around who's here today. Because as I look at you, I see a lot of fruit flying around. It's called the fruit of the Spirit. Of love and joy and peace and kindness and gentleness and go down the list. And we're filled with the glory of God. People of God, God expects results. He anticipates that with all the work that he has done, with all the preparation of the tree, especially that cross, there's going to be fruit that's going to come from it. And so it is in our lives as well. When our Lord has priority in our lives, we will hold loosely to what material possessions we have, because we'll realize where our treasure is, that's where our heart's going to be too. And so we live a full and abundant life under his grace, and by his Holy Spirit working in us, we bear fruit. We bear much fruit, more fruit, better fruit. And as Christians, we live by faith and are to be putting out branches that bear fruit because of the power of Christ that dwells within us. Yes, through faith, our giving becomes a joy. So we go back to that question. Let's ask it again. Do I have a vital connection with Christ Jesus? Say that with me. Do I have a vital connection with Christ Jesus? And as we look at God's word, the answer, of course, is yes. Yes, you do. You have a vital connection with Jesus. It began in your baptism when you clothed yourself with Christ. Yes, you have a vital connection with Jesus. It continues when we take part in communion, when we commune in the body and blood of Christ, where he says, "Take and eat, this is my body. Take and drink, this is my blood." That's a vital connection to our Lord. Yes, you've got him. Or rather, I should say, he's got us, doesn't he? And God expects a result from us. So let's pray now as we connect ourselves to the vine. Heavenly Father, we come to you knowing our limitations. We come to you knowing your promises. We come to you knowing that now is the time to ask for your assistance in our fruit production. And may your word challenge us to be all that you would have us to be. And may your Holy Spirit guide and direct us, as we know we cannot do this on our own. And may the one who redeemed us and saved us remain in us always, so that we may become the best fruit producers for Christ as we remain in him. Help us to stay close to these promises. And help us when we fall not to get discouraged. And help us when we win to give all of you all the glory. And help us to depend on you. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let us stand as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. We speak the creed together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born under the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven. He sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as our offertory as we offer ourselves and to stay connected to Jesus. This morning we use that hymn, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Stand as we come to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, you have grafted us into the vine of your Son. Prune us and cut off from us all sin and dead works, that we may always draw life from your Son and produce the fruits of faith and good works. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, your only Son came into the flesh to bear our sin and to be our Savior. Protect us from all false teaching and the spirit of the Antichrist, that we may always confess Christ to be our only true God and remain faithful to him. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Father and teacher of all truth, guide teachers and all students in your word. We pray especially now as we begin in-person Sunday school and adult Bible study on Sunday mornings, that you may increase all of our understanding and faith and love for you, the Lamb led to the slaughter in our place and risen from the dead. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
Father God, we come this morning celebrating new life. As on yesterday, May 1st, you blessed Spencer and his wife Joel with a healthy baby boy, Finley Joel Owen, 6 pounds, 13 ounces, and 19 and 3/4 inches. Bless this family, and may Finley grow up in your presence, and may you shower him with your love and your grace. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Almighty God, give health and guidance to our president and all in authority, that they may serve honorably and in accord with your good order. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
The merciful God, you hear and answer your children in their hour of need. This morning we looked up Don Clippinger, who's going through much testing and he needs your presence, Lord. We lift up Dane Thompson as he won't be having surgery this week and it could be very serious. We lift up baby James, little JJ, as we found him last week in the NICU, and today we find him out of NICU, still in the hospital, but Lord, we thank you for the healing that you're giving him. We lift up Sean Brim, and Lord, Sean has been in intensive care ICU on life support all week. We place him into your care and ask for your will to be done as he fights for life. Continue to be with Christopher Rodriguez, Sherry Moll as she fights cancer, Creighton, who has some issues of disturbance, and he needs your presence, Lord. We thank you for Julie Nairn's healing as she is able to worship with us today. Be with Tuna Trujillo and his treatments. John Jordan, as he continues to go through more testing and more testing. For his mother, Eileen, who is in Georgia with many issues. We continue to pray for Jackie's dad, Winston, for Roy Robertson and Clifford Ricks, for Kim Leyva and Randy Escobar, for Michelle London, for Greta, Lord. We thank you that Greta's with us this morning, but it's been a hard week for her. Just surround her with love and care and your presence and touch. Continue to be with Linda Arnie and Lisa Shava, for Matthew Harden and Vera Durham, for Mark and Kelly Peterson, Melly and Joel DeSante, for Jim Culpepper and Mary Lehman, for Pastor Storr and Evie Mobley, for Donna Kinder and Linda Tony Brown, Shelley Moore, Eric Romero, Karen Marquise, and all others whom we name at this time. Grant that they would bear their crosses with faith, ever looking to you, and so fix their hearts where true joy is found. Lord, in your mercy, Heavenly Father, you are gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Hear and answer our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, and your saints shall bless you through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. It's great seeing all of you here. Stay connected to the vine. Receive now the benediction. May the Lord bless you, keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. And our closing hymn is Mighty to Save.